Here in this folder is the smallest possible executable file, coming in at a mere 0 bytes. So technically you can take a blank file and rename it with the .exe extension, but if it can't run, it doesn't really count. So what makes an exe actually executable? To help explain exactly that, I reached out to my good friend, William Gates, who sent me this archival footage from Microsoft they used to show to new operating systems engineers.
Hi, and welcome to the wonderful world of Windows. Today, we're going to be taking a look at the Windows Portable Executable file format. Once you've written your program in a high-level language like C or C++, you'll want to throw it through the compiler, assembler, and linker to produce the final image of the program in the form of a Windows Portable Executable, colloquially known by the file extension EXE. This file contains what is called an image of the program, captured in a state ready to be run by the computer. The PE file contains a series of headers, which contain information about the file's different sections, which contain the code, data, and references to external symbols that are required by the program, with your code now compiled to machine code for the specified instruction set architecture. For the Windows operating system to run the EXE, it'll verify that the file is a valid executable by checking the headers, load the code, data, and other sections into memory, resolve any of those external dependencies with the proper dynamic link library, and then begin the program's execution from the specified entry point. So if you ever think that Windows doesn't have enough bloat, just remember that every EXE still contains the string. This program cannot be run in DOS mode in the MS-DOS legacy header.
But creating an executable isn't as straightforward as C code in equals machine code out. This simple Hello World program, once compiled, is 111,104 bytes. That's 1,736 times larger than the source code file. But even though this program is written using only 64 bytes worth of characters, what is it actually doing? It's including the standard I/O library, which relies on the default standard libraries and system APIs provided by the OS, which allows the program to elegantly call the printf function to output text to the console without having to worry about the details of directly dealing with the said complexities of the operating system. That's the key thing to understand. Programs are made for systems. Whether it's for Windows, Mac, Linux, your Xbox, or your homemade smartwatch, that compiled program is explicitly designed to interact with that system. And that's great because those operating systems are in turn designed to deal with the device's hardware and provide that layer of abstraction that allows programmers to type only a couple of lines of code and change the pixels on a monitor. But what is the minimum viable program that an operating system like Windows will load and execute? In other words, what is the smallest possible EXE? To create the smallest possible EXE, all we have to do is create a minimal program, remove everything that isn't absolutely necessary in the resulting file, and then squeeze it to make it even smaller until something finally breaks. So to start, I'll create the smallest possible program right here. Yeah, it's super boring, which is why I'm also making a second program that will create a message box. It'll be a little bigger, but at least it'll do something that will be visually interesting. Now, compiling this version of the program normally with Microsoft Standard MSVC in 64-bit mode produces a program that is 114,688 bytes. The original minimal version isn't far behind at 114,176 bytes. But once I set the linker option to not include any standard libraries, we've already slashed the byte count down to only 976 and 640 bytes respectively. And to confirm, yes, these programs still run as normal. Now, the next step is to ditch the C code and meet up with a good friend of mine, x86 assembly. And we'll also switch out from using the Microsoft assembler to the NetWide assembler so that we can write out the entire PE file, headers and all, and assemble it all at once to be extremely accurate with what our output will be. The message box version now sits at 864 bytes, while the minimal version has briefly bounced back to 848 bytes. That may seem like we're heading in the wrong direction, but now it's time to really start cutting the fat by getting rid of some of the optional and unneeded parts of the file. Goodbye rich header, goodbye DOS stub, goodbye debug table and the ASCII art of a shrub. Message box version now comes in at 416 bytes, minimal version down to 336 bytes. And this is about as small as the program can legally be squeezed, and by that I mean that beyond this point, there is no guarantee that this program will work with future versions of Windows because it's time to break the file header. Most of the new savings come from smashing the PE header into the MS-DOS legacy header. We can't get rid of it completely as Windows still checks for the MZ at the beginning of the file, but then it just jumps to location 3C to grab the offset of where the PE header starts. And it just so happens that if the PE header starts at location 04, then 3C will line up with the section alignment value of the header, which can also be 4. In addition, many of the other values in these headers aren't even being used, so I can use them to store my strings for the message box, which brings me down to an even 400 bytes. And for the minimal version, I've gotten it as low as 268 bytes, but it's here that I've hit the proverbial bedrock. There are actually still a bunch of junk zeros at the end of this file. Theoretically, it could come down to 210 bytes with what I have now, because normally you can just delete the trailing zeros since the file will be loaded into memory on a page full of zeros. But no matter what I've done, it just won't load the file if it's less than 268 bytes. It seems that several sources confirm that 268 bytes is the smallest possible executable size that will run on 64-bit Windows. Why? Well, that might be a better question for Dave. However, for other versions of Windows, executables can get as small as 97 bytes. But again, most of these programs don't really do much. Although in the 64-bit Windows version, since it's stuck at 268 bytes, some people have actually squeezed in a couple of DLL calls to create a message box or open the Windows calculator. So there is some room to get things done, but is it enough space to fit a whole game into here? No. Well, at least not a good game. I'm not sure Typing Simulator would become a bestseller on Steam. But how small could you squeeze a game? First of all, I won't be able to include any standard libraries. This game will have to rely 100% on whatever the Windows API provides. So it's time we meet another good friend of mine, the kernel, kernel 32. Kernel32.dll is one of the core DLLs that provide functions for interacting with the Windows operating system. It can provide everything from memory management, process management, file system access, and certain I/O. And it really shouldn't be too hard to build a game using these basic kernel-provided functions, because that's literally what every game and every program does at its core. To start the game, I'm first faced with two main options for the program subsystem, that is, the type of Windows environment in which the program will be executed, either a console or window. Going with the latter would allow for more graphical control, but I'd have to explicitly create the window myself. Whereas if the subsystem is set to console, then a console is automatically provided for me if the program isn't run through the terminal already. But wait, consoles aren't for games, consoles are for slow, asynchronous I/O. Well, yes, that can be true, but it doesn't have to be. In fact, your precious console, which pretends to act like a fancy text editor, is mostly a well-oiled illusion. Any keyboard input that is echoed as character output is done so quite on purpose. Before getting into I/O, we'll first need to get the handle of our console, which is a token that represents a system-controlled resource. Our console has both an input and output handle that we can get by using the kernel's getStandardHandle function. To use this in our assembly code, we can create an external reference to it, then push the parameters of the function to the stack, then we'll call that function. Using the Microsoft Macro Assembler, we could also use the invoke keyword to pass on the parameters like this, which looks more like calling a function in a high-level language, but it's just a shortcut for what really happens. If we pass -10 to the getStandardHandle function, it'll return the standard input handle of the console, and -11 will give us the standard output handle. We'll keep both of these in a variable since we'll be doing both input and output later. Output is much easier to achieve as we can use the kernel's writeConsoleA function to pass our output handle, pointer to the buffer containing our output ASCII string, the number of characters we'll write in our string, a pointer to the dword that returns the actual number of characters written, and then one more zero. Doing that, we can already write output to the console, and here's the first trick up my sleeve, color. Now you could use a couple of other functions from kernel 32 to change the current color of the console's characters, but back in 2016, Microsoft reintroduced support in the console for old ANSI escape sequences, which are codes made up of mostly standard ASCII characters that can control terminal formatting. Everything from setting the cursor location, text color, console size, console title, and a whole lot more. However, to ensure it'll work properly, I do have to use the setConsoleMode function to ensure that virtual terminal processing is enabled. But after that, I can be quite sure that ANSI escape codes like this will be able to modify the console's output formatting just by calling the same writeConsole function. which will save a lot of program space to not have to use functions like setConsoleCursorInfo, which I would have called to make the cursor invisible, but this ANSI string has the same result. As for the game world, I'll take 48 bytes of data, and for each 0 in those bytes, output a sky character, and for each 1, a meteor. The sky is the full block ASCII character, with text color set to blue, and the meteor is the lower half block character in dark yellow, with the background set to red. Then, after every 4 bytes, I write the new line character to the console, which creates this 32x12 grid. For the protagonists, I wasn't sure which ASCII character to go with, but I narrowed it down to these 3 and decided to give the house a try. I can use the setConsoleCursorPosition function to set the Y of the cursor to the bottom row of the world and the X position to the player's X value from 0 to 31. Then call the same writeConsole function to output the player's character. There is a bit of flicker here as the background and player are both reprinted sequentially at around 60 FPS. To fix that, I could stick these into an output buffer before writing to the screen, but to minimize the amount of code in the final program, I won't. To get user input from the console, I can use the readConsoleInputA kernel32 function, and that returns an input record, which is a structure that contains different event types, such as when the window is brought into focus, cursor input, or the only thing I'm interested in, key events, which will then attach a key event record structure that contains what I'm looking for, the ASCII character of the keyboard input. Now let me test if this code is working correctly here. It should echo whatever the user types back out onto the console. Okay, and that works twice as well as I expected. It looks like the issue here is that there is a key event for both pressing a key and releasing a key, so I have to check this part of the key event record that tells us whether the key is being held down or released. And that's more like it now. Although it is a little sketchy since the non-ASCII keys are also outputting character data. Here's the output of the character chart from 0 to 255 for reference, but that shouldn't be anything to worry about since I'm not actually going to be outputting anything the user types anyways. I'm just checking whether the user presses the left or right arrow keys and then moving the player along the bottom row accordingly. Then every few frames the meteors will move down a layer, and a new layer of meteors will be randomly generated. And without a standard library to just make random numbers magically appear, there are a few options I can go with to implement that same magical functionality by using the Windows API. Though none of them are found in the kernel32 library, but in the Advanced API Services library. One method is to use the Microsoft Cryptography API, but that requires quite a few functions to set up, and I'm trying to keep it minimal, so I'll go with the RTL GenRandom function, also known as SystemFunction36. That's literally what I have to import it as in the program. But all I need to do is specify the destination buffer and how many random bytes I want, and then I can take 4 random bytes, and them with 4 others to try to save some space between meteors, and then add those to the top layer. Once the meteors reach the bottom layer, I can take these last 4 bytes, throw them into a single 32-bit register, then roll the bits to the left 32 minus the character's X position times to load the object at the location the player is standing into the carry flag. Again, 0 for the sky, 1 for a meteor. If it's a 1, then the player has been squished by a meteor and it's, as the kids say, game over. I've added a points counter to the top using 4 packed BCD bytes, that's 2 digits 0 to 9 per byte, and I can make great use of the x86 decimal adjust AL after addition instruction to correctly perform BCD addition. Big thumbs up for CISC, right guys? This score gets output to the screen every frame, followed by the world and the player. After drawing the frame, checking the input, and running all the game logic, I can use the sleep function to suspend the current thread for a number of specified milliseconds. I have it set to 16 milliseconds for a target of 60 FPS, but of course that doesn't account for program execution time, so it will be slower than that. I could use the getLocalTime function instead to see if 16 milliseconds has passed since the last frame was drawn, but that would cost a few more precious bytes of data, so again, I won't. Once the player is crushed, the program will use my favorite kernel32 function, beep. And I just have to read this description from the Microsoft documentation here. A long time ago, all PC computers shared a common 8254 programmable interval timer chip for the generation of primitive sounds, but then everything changed when the sound cards attacked. I may have added that last part there, but it's still a cool function. You can just drop in the frequency that you want and the duration of the sound, and then... You could do something really cool with this function, like make the world's smallest digital piano. Granted, it's not a good piano, but it is the smallest. Fun side quest, but back to the game at hand. After assembling with Masm, the program weighs in at 2,448 bytes. And after really trying to cut the fat without breaking the headers, because I do want this to be playable on future systems, I've got it down to 2,358 bytes. And the last piece of the puzzle is another good friend of mine, the Crinkler. Crinkler is a compressing linker for Windows. It takes the place of the standard Windows linker, turning our object file into a compressed version of an EXE, which then decompresses when you run it. It's not cheating because I make up the rules here. So after crinkling my game, it manages to sneak into the under 1K club at 825 bytes. Here it is after I turned it into a QR code hanging on my fridge. And by the way, the world's smallest piano weighed in at 1,584 bytes before crinkling and 555 bytes afterwards. So the only question I have now is, what is the largest possible EXE? Theoretically, a PE32 file could be no larger than 4 gigabytes, since that's the 32-bit addressing limit. But for jump instructions, it would have to use a signed 32-bit digit, so the limit should be around 2 gigabytes. PE32 Plus, the 64-bit version of the file, does have a special flag to say that it can handle addresses larger than 2 gigabytes. However, once again, we're limited by Windows itself. It doesn't seem to be able to handle executables, both PE32 and PE32 Plus, that are greater than around 1.85 gigabytes. Of course, if you've opened Chrome in the last 2 years, you'll know that programs can take well over 2, 4, or even 8 gigs of memory. Basically, they'll just take whatever you throw at them. But I'm only talking about Windows loading a large executable. I don't care how big it gets once it's open. And for the record, Chrome.exe is only 2.66 megabytes, Steam.exe is 4.18, Excel.exe is 66, and even Photoshop.exe is only 160 megabytes. As for the exact maximum number of bytes that Windows can take, I simply took one of the last versions of the programs we were shrinking before and threw between 1.8 and 2 gigabytes worth of zeros on the end, and did a binary search to find which would load and run and which wouldn't. bytes. Completing the entire range of runnable executables on 64-bit Windows. Thanks once again to Brilliant, check them out down below, and until next time.